Building credits?
For contractors. I signed one this morning.
Did you? You say certificates for free shirts? I'm sorry, what?
We didn't sign a deal.
I think it's only for loggers that get the credit.
You're not a logger?
No. Seems like us excavation guys should get more than, I mean, the free lunch is awesome.
He gets a dollar. Scratch out logger on one of the sheets, not excavator.
There you go.
Construction expert.
Yeah.
How you guys doing?
Good.
Nice to be here. Usually my audiences are greasy mechanics, so.
I used to be a mechanic.
This is a nice little change.
See me a mechanic, come on, dude.
I'm one of the safety coordinators for Peterson.
Peterson Tractor.
You got safety glasses on. Peterson Tractor, there's Peterson Power Systems, and there's Peterson Machinery, which is the Oregon folks, right? So I cover the Northern California stores, six of them. And then there's three in Southern Oregon that I work at too, which is Klamath Falls, Medford, and Coos Bay. So I'm traveling. You can find me on the roads.
I'll leave that to some days.
We're passing each other, huh? Where are you at?
Roseburg and Coos Bay.
And what do you do?
Equipment manager for them.
Equipment manager? Cool. How many pieces of equipment?
Lots. Not as many as we used to have.
That's a perfect management.
Yeah, pretty skinny what they used to be.
Oh, man. We've lost a lot of them. Still got quite a few.
So you're in the, yeah, so you got a wide variety of stuff that you deal with.
Mm-hmm.
We're just going to kind of talk about some of the practices that we do with safety for Peterson, and hopefully you can get something out of that as far as maybe you can implement that into your programs at work. The world we live in now is getting safer and safer, and there's really nothing we can do about it except jump in and put our safety glasses on. I don't know what else to do because it's a huge animal, you know, as you all know. And we'll talk a little bit about that, share some successes, share some stories for sure. And just talk about kind of best practices that we have as a company. We've come a long way in our safety practices too. I started in 2003. I went to Sac State and have a background in occupational health and safety. And I got a job right out of college, fortunately, doing some training stuff. That was back in 2002 when they were giving jobs out, right?
Yeah.
Now you're a doctor, you can't get anything. So that's a pretty fun place to work, that's for sure. There's lots of stuff to do. There's lots of traveling. That's fun. You get to meet a lot of people and improve. Everything that we do is improving on safety. So we've come a long way from people being resistant to safety glasses to that person conducting a safety meeting. Are you guys familiar with a kind of a culture shift in safety over the years? When you first started, what was it like as far as safety goes?
Safety was just a cost, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't really embrace it, but
mm-hmm.
you know, you had safety committees, and I was the chairman for 1 year, and then the office manager was the next year, and we just did it to do the paperwork.
Kind of did it because you had to.
Yeah, and then Knife River took over, and oh my God.
Didn't you learn what safety was?
Yeah, it really did, because then you start seeing your costs and everything, mm-hmm. and the cost of somebody getting something in their eye or stitches in their finger, or you know,
mm-hmm.
we had two finger incidents last year. And I think the cheapest one was like $30,000.
It just comes down to risk, right? It's just insurance and risk. You know?
Yeah.
So there's a cost associated with that. You get into a lot of fender benders every year, you're going to have high insurance.
Yeah, see, we're self-insured on all of our auto and everything. So, man, if a piece of equipment gets vandalized or wrecked or something, it comes right out of our budget. You know?
You don't have a $200 deductible.
Yeah.
No way.
It has really changed. So just the culture. And it's a continuing thing. We just get deeper and deeper and deeper.
It's not going to go away.
We went through Oregon Sharp program, and now we're going on to DuPont.
Okay.
And there's, you know, the best thing about our whole safety culture in Knife River was, mm-hmm. is we had all these things that we knew that they were bad, but we couldn't fix them.
Yeah.
And then when they decided to go with Sharp,
mm-hmm.
it's like, okay, guys, we're going to fix all this stuff. And, you know, electrical upgrades and tooling and, you know, guardrails and handrails
mm-hmm.
and the crusher sites and stuff like that. It was
mm-hmm.
probably the biggest.
Lockout, tag out.
Mm-hmm. Build our own programs for all that.
Yeah, energy control is big.
Yeah.
Especially at Peterson, we have the EPG technicians that work on generators and all kinds of stuff regarding even marine stuff too. We're out of the Bay Area, so there's all kinds of boats we go on to and service their engines. It's just a big.
Well, now MSHA, you know.
MSHA,
You know, I mean, if you want to go to prison the rest of your life, you can just avoid safety, you know?
Yeah.
Pretty much, yeah.
They get really brought.
You really get into trouble when you know about something that's unsafe and you don't do anything to fix it.
Yeah.
I think that would be one thing to take away from here. I don't think any of you were.
And you can't hide from it either.
No, you can't.
You either embrace it and get on with it or get out, you know?
Well, we got three people that are running around the territory of Peterson doing the safety training, doing the hazard inspection, doing new employee orientation, doing injury investigations, and I'm one of them. Instead, I'm in Northern California, Southern Oregon. We also have Eric Dawes. He's up in Portland and Longview, Washington. And then we have Mallory Carr. You may have seen earlier. She had to catch a flight. But she's out of the Bay Area doing a couple stores down there. So I got the best territory, though. I got a big, wide range of places I got to drive, but it's cool. It's really fun. So I don't want to be down in the Bay Area down that rat race. You guys spend any time down there at all?
Just a visit.
Well,
just
a visit.
A few times. But
well, let's go around the room, kind of introduce yourself, and maybe where you're
at. All over the
way. You're all day.
Dwayne Grant. I've been in Brownsburg and worked for a long time.
Okay. A lot of injuries?
Loggers.
Loggers?
Yes.
What's your biggest risk?
Biggest risk?
What's your biggest injuries? What's your most common injuries?
Trip, slip, and fall.
Oh, okay.
That's the worst. Well, it's not the worst. That's the most common.
Mm-hmm.
The worst is last year we had a guy too close to him, turned logs that was headed out. Mm-hmm. One of the logs swung around this way, hit him in the shoulder, damaged all the nerves going to this arm. Now they're talking about we're going to.
Oh, God.
You know,
oh,
yeah.
Log doesn't care if you're in the way, does it?
No. It's got no eyes, it's got no feeling.
It just moves. It's energy. Energy is either moving or about to move, right? Whether it's electrical, hydraulic, stored energy.
There's quite a lot of energy and that stuff on the hillside.
How about back here?
I'm Randy Kephart. I'm with Knife River.
Yep.
River in Goose Bay. And probably our most, what we figure is our most potential for an injury is hands and eyes.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's what we concentrate on. I furnish my guys with like five different pairs of gloves to wear, mm-hmm. you know, safety glasses. We use goggles, depending on what it is. Face shields, we try to double up, but that's mm-hmm. every time we have an accident, it's a hand or a face shield, or a
yeah.
eyes or a hand.
Eye injuries are frustrating. Why do we have eye injuries? We have safety glasses, we have face shields. Why do we still have eye injuries? Put them right here on our hat. How about right here?
Troy Blackledge, work for West Coast Resources. We mine chromite in Coos Bay, and we're just south of there. In my experience of mining, slip strips and falls.
Back injuries?
Not so much. We've got engineering controls a lot of times for
good.
That, but it does happen.
Mm-hmm. When you talk about engineering controls, there's three ways to eliminate a hazard, right? What are those three ways?
I'm trying to remember. There's engineering control, there's administrative control, and something like, I think the implementation, the actual on-site mechanical control or something like that.
Or just eliminate it. We can't do that, though, usually. Damn it, we can't get rid of these machines, we need them.
Yeah.
Good, what's you?
Tim Smith, West Coast Contractors and Resources.
Nice to meet you, Tim.
You too.
Put on safety meetings?
Occasionally.
Conduct them?
I try to be more sit back and
delegate.
Yeah. And we've got a safety consultant who's been once a month.
Good. That works for you?
It helps. You know, it's always good to have extra eyes.
Does that person work with
you?
Oh,
no, he's a consultant. Yeah, he works with us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, he gets, I don't know if you follow that safety directions.
Mm-hmm.
He travels all the state. I don't know that he gets into California much.
Okay.
He does all.
He stays clear of California. He's
yeah.
smart.
We work in California, though.
I live up in Northern California. It's like a different state.
Yeah, we've actually got a yard over at Eureka.
Oh, cool.
We're building a dock down there at Cunadet right now.
What's the common hazard at your workplace?
Slip, trips, and falls.
You don't even have to fall to get hurt, right? You can
no,
just spill like that.
So much bad yeah. stuff happens around us. Heavy, you know, everything we use heavy.
Uh-huh.
Piling. Those guys, I mean, just everything you do is heavy, so.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Are there
Seth Brown. I work here in Eugene for an excavation company. Mm-hmm. A lot of site work and pipe work and grading type stuff.
Shoring?
We do, yeah, exactly. We don't get too deep very often, but once in a while we'll have to get a slide rail system where we have a couple coffin boxes and trench shields that we can use.
How much does a cubic yard of dirt weigh?
It depends on
the dirt. Is dirt hazardous?
It can be.
Absolutely.
It can be. You know what? A little speck of dirt in your eyeball.
Oh, my God.
Or you can get a dump truck put a dump on you. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we have a specific hazard that's the most dangerous.
One that's really frustrating to you?
You know what?
Seems like you train on it all the time.
Well, you know what we talk about a lot of time is cleanliness.
Housekeeping?
Housekeeping. Particularly when we're in traffic. We have trucks that run up and down the road. Mm-hmm. And, those guys are spilling rocks.
Yeah.
A lot of times the damage we're doing isn't to ourselves or other people.
Oh, but geez. You're kidding yourself, huh? You put on safety meetings there?
Personally? We do. Yeah, yeah. I do too. A lot like Knife River, weren't much into that for a while. Mm-hmm. That was just, it just slowed down production. If you had to stop talking and running, you're just going to get out there and get to work, get something done.
We'll talk about that a lot, the culture of a safety environment. Do people do it because, here comes Tyler, I got to put on my safety glasses? Or I do it because I don't want to get hurt?
Right, right.
That's tough. That's tough.
It is. A lot of people are just doing it because they see somebody come.
Peterson's no different. I mean, we're getting there. It's tough. It's not easy. We're not perfect by any means.
Yeah. A lot of the stuff that makes uncomfortable.
It's a culture.
It's a big old Titanic ship. You can't just turn it on a dime.
It's a lot easier for the new guys coming in to train them right. Mm-hmm. But the guys that have been there through the 30 years, man, that's your problem.
I got some slides on that particular guy. We got a bunch of slides. We might not get through them all if we don't. It's not that big of a deal. We got a bunch of handouts too and a CD with a lot of material on it for you guys to use, utilize, make your own. Steal, copy it, do it as you want. It might help you, it might not. Do what you want with it. How about the back row here? I forgot about you.
Steve DeBerry, works for Road Waste Systems down in Bethany, Oregon. Currently out, my place is out at the landfills.
Okay. How long have you been there?
Huh?
How long have you been there?
About 17, going on 18 years.
Wow, nice.
So,
it's always going to be trash.
Yeah, we've had our down, people being more conservative.
Recycling.
If you're not building houses or anything like that,
that's true.
25% of our waste streams.
Yeah, you think of household garbage, and it's really not as much as
So we get paid our too. So.
What's the biggest hazard?
I think backs.
Okay,
I don't know what it is, but it seems like the operator's sitting there. Equipment too long, and then they get up.
We have the same problem at Peterson. We have mechanics that just jump onto to a physically demanding job, and then 10 minutes later they have a back strain or a shoulder strain, or just doing something pretty mundane, you think, but it turns out to be, I'm on work for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's tough to train too.
It is.
It's tough to train in habits. Experience that. You talked about older and experienced employees, right? Old dogs and new tricks. It's definitely tough. Well, good. It's nice to meet you all. Thanks for coming, too. This is fun. Like I said, this is new to me, because I usually have a box of donuts and a bunch of greasy mechanics. So. This is much better.
We got cookies.
There we go. Well, we'll kind of go through this. Just some slides. Like I said, there's handouts and safety resources on CDs. Blank inspection forms you can use if you want. If you have one, maybe you can add to it. I don't know if you have something that your company uses, but you can certainly use ours if you want to. Maybe take a couple things out of it and make it onto your own. Please do that for sure. I think this presentation is on the CD too, so I'm not sure. There's that safety culture again, right? The big question, how do you do safety? What's your safety culture? Do you measure and manage your safety performance? You guys are all measured on crunching numbers and equipment maintenance. You're being evaluated on that. But are you being evaluated on your safety?
You bet.
Yeah. Is that your boss that's coming? And what's he grading you on?
Well, we have accountability measures. You have site inspections that you have to do quarterly. You have toolbox meetings that are done every week. We have JHAs that we have to do. Accident investigations. God, I could go on forever. But
yeah. Really, you don't even get graded on the number of injuries, right? You might, but it's not the biggest part of it. And it kind of used to be that way, right? And we Peterson was in the same boat. Oh, you did good on your safety. You didn't have any accidents last quarter. Well, we got lucky, right? Yeah, we got lucky. Yeah, it's part of the safety culture is changing and how we account, you know, how we manage our managers, right? The accountability of managers. Critical elements of the zero accidents approach, managing for prevention rather than from reaction. Does that hold true for you guys? It sucks to react to something and change it, huh?
We used to be there.
How about you? More of a proactive culture or a reactive?
Proactive.
Did it used to be reactive?
No, it's been pretty much.
That's good.
Yeah. That's good. I mean, it's really strong now, but more so.
I was going to say, the way Hemshaw is these days, you have to be proactive. You can't be proactive or you won't be in business.
No, that's true. That's true. They don't care, right?
They don't care.
You know how much it costs for us to do that?
Okay.
Next question. Completing documenting. Oh, gosh, documenting. Safety is all about documenting, right? Cover your ass, as they say. Document the meeting. We're going to have a meeting about all these meetings we're having. Right. Clear accountability for measurable safety results. We have an accountability form too that we'd like to share with you guys as well, what we use for our managers, and you can certainly implement that. Take stuff from it. Don't use it at all. It doesn't matter. But it might be similar to what you said. You mentioned about 8 of them that we do the same thing on. So weekly tailgate meetings. Are those being conducted by you or other employees?
By myself or one of the shop foremans, and then each operating group has to do that. Each job site has to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And the managers go out and routinely go out to different spots to make sure that they're being done.
Mm-hmm. How about you right here? Do you do those or other employees?
Mm-hmm. We do a job site specific.
Good.
You know, so it'll be me sometimes, but a lot of times it'll just be a foreman on a job site.
Sure.
Sometimes it's through the general contractor on a job site if we're working for another contractor.
Nice. I'm just giving you a lay of the land before you jump into it. So.
Yeah. Or if the tasks change much.
Sure.
You know, we might go more often or less often.
We don't work on assembly lines, do we?
Nope. Not even close.
Every day is different, right? Good. Same with us, too. Timely, appropriate follow-up for incidents and accidents. That's huge as far as a safety culture goes, and we've learned that, too, over the years, that the faster and the more timely you can respond to a near miss, even, too, that really adds value to the safety culture because people can learn from that. They realize that we take it really seriously. We want to learn from that and show everybody that what happened. A near miss or a close call is really a perfect safety meeting, isn't it? Nobody got hurt. Nobody's at home missing a finger. And it was a learning experience. So if you don't investigate your near misses or close calls, start doing it. That'd be good advice for me. Do it. Mm-hmm. Report it like an incident, too. You know, if you have an online reporting,
there's a form for near misses.
Do you? People use it?
Yeah. We're starting to use it more and more.
Good.
There's still people that try to sweep it under the carpet.
Troy and I are, we're in a, what would you call it, a joint safety steering committee right now with one of our main customers that we're running for.
Good.
We're looking through Take Two. Have you been involved in Take Two?
No.
So there's a lot of stuff going on there in the Take Two safety program.
Cool.
DuPont. DuPont. Yeah.
I've got a lot of information from Caterpillar for safety meetings too. I'll share with you guys at the end of the presentation. You can grab stuff, and there's all kinds of specific industry stuff too. There's forestry, there's mining, excavation, anything on there, and it's pretty cool. You can take it. And then we did a lot of behavioral safety starting in about 2005. Are you guys familiar with behavioral safety? This is something I think you'll all get something out of because. When you think about all the injuries and accidents out there, 90% of them are caused by somebody's behavior. I wish it wasn't that way. I wish it was more, this car broke down and that guy got hurt because this tool failed and this guy hurt his hand. This crane broke and that's why it fell to the ground. Easy investigation, right? But when you add into behavior with an investigation, that's when you really get down to the root causes of what caused it. Usually if somebody being in a hurry, it's somebody being complacent with what they're doing. What's complacency mean?
So the take two thing, there's actually a list of about 10 things that you just step back and take 2 minutes and go through that list and evaluate, you know, is this safe, is this safe, is this safe, do I need permits, do I? It's pretty nice.
So it kind of goes through the motions of not of counteracting complacency.
Behavioral, yeah.
Absolutely.
It's an effort
in that regard.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, there's a program out there called Safe Start. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but that it's all behavioral safety. And they talk about being rushing, being fatigued, being complacent, and those things, types of things get you into the line of fire. They cause you to lose your balance, traction, grip, which I think you all would benefit from as far as researching Safe Start. And they can also take you, being in one of those behavioral states can lead you to take your eyes and your mind off of task. And that's been so true in our injury investigations, and our accidents have gone down tremendously based on the training of behaviors. So I would really encourage you to look into that. The company is called Safe Start. They have a series of videos and workbooks. Guys love it. Guys love it. You can apply it to everything. You can apply it to working at home or on the roads. And we all know driving is probably one of the most easiest things to become complacent at. And it's probably one of the most hazardous things that we do on a daily basis. So it certainly relates to driving at home. Using a weed whacker, using a chainsaw, putting ornaments on your roof and stuff like that. You don't, might not think about safety at home as much as you should, because I think it's like a 2-to-1 ratio. You're more likely to get hurt at home than you are at work. It might not seem like that with all the training you get, but yeah, homes are dangerous, especially stairs and power tools.
Yeah. It might be alcohol at home.
The chemical effect of that, right? Well, good. Culture's big. I mean, you got to have a good culture to get anywhere in safety. And don't do it. Don't do it because I'm walking through the shop. You know, when the guy's mindset is, do it because of me. I want to go home with all my fingers and toes. You had a pretty good program there. And when that same person can do a suggestion for a safety meeting, participate in a safety meeting, you're right there. You're good. I mean, that's pretty good. Pretty good. Do you guys have a lot of involvement in your safety meetings, or are you just reading about forklifts?
Usually try to make it as
good.
More people have to discuss.
Engaged, right? Mm-hmm. That's hard, right?
It is.
It's a tough sell.
Yeah.
They're not in the business of buying it sometimes.
A lot of times if you get the others to do the safety copy, then it gets them more open, and then pretty soon everybody's involved. If you just sit and read it, they're just going to listen to you.
Kind of tune out. What is your safety culture? I think there's some good ones here. Nobody's perfect, as we all know. We always want to get better. How is your safety performance? Do you know what it is? Do you care? Your customers do, right? What do you track and measure? We'll go through some acronyms here as far as what insurance people look at. And I know you guys might use something similar. But you almost have to be really, really safe these days and explain that to your customers before you even go on their site. Peterson has run into that before too, where we've had to document what our like incident rate is, or whatever sort of number of injuries we're having per year. The customer wants to know that before we can even work on your site. It might even some of you guys.
Some customers won't let you on their site.
Exactly right. Exactly right. They're probably looking at one of these, right?
Yeah, the TIR.
TIR. There you go. You guys are probably familiar with those acronyms in the safety and insurance and the risk management world, days away. It's one thing to have a first aid injury, it's one thing to have a recordable injury. When you got a lost time recordable injury, that's like a collision in on a car, you know, compared to a door dent. Workers' compensation, that X mod, you're probably familiar with that too. If you're not, it's just another way to a metric to manage, to highlight what you're doing as far as the number of injuries. Now, you can break these down so many different ways, but it all comes down to how many injuries are you having per 100 employees, per your whole shop. How many injuries did you guys have last year? You remember recordable injuries?
One.
Pretty good. How many employees?
17 at the landfill site, yeah.
Good.
That's not company-wide. But
Sure. So. Lost time recordable?
Yeah, back injury.
Back injury, yeah. What do you do for back injury? You rest.
Yeah.
I mean, what do you do?
Doctor BJ, here's some muscle relaxers, go home.
How about Dwayne? How many injuries do you recall?
We keep track of everything from poison oak, bee stings.
Good.
You know, like I said, a slip, trip, and falls are more common. Sprained ankle, sprained wrist.
When you have,
we probably have close to 25 or 30 total.
When you have a culture of
plus
not
the one major.
When you have a culture of not reporting, then that's not a good culture either. You really want to encourage people to report these in a timely manner. Guys are still afraid of getting in trouble. You know, like we can all relate to that. But the more open you are, and the more communication you are, that's what we'd love to.
That was the case in our situation.
Is that right?
The guy hurt his back. They want to say anything.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he couldn't work and kind of really muddied up the water.
And it probably wouldn't have been as bad if he had reported in a timely manner.
Right. Yeah.
So you're almost more disappointed in that person because of not reporting on time than they are having an injury.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes.
Why did you tell me?
Well, it's harder, you know, when they fill out the 801, it's, well, this happened 3 weeks ago, but he's just not reporting if he went over. Like,
yeah. He might as well ride a motorcycle on the
weekend.
Yeah. Remodeling his bathroom.
In California, do you guys have preferred workers, things like that, where you bring somebody, an injured worker from somebody else back to work and put them on?
Uh-huh. Return to work program, yeah. So Oregon's pretty good.
We had a guy who we brought back who re-injured himself last year. It was the same injury that he had, you know, previous.
When you brought him back, did you almost have to treat him like a new employee with a job?
Oh, yeah, because he wasn't one of ours. He was not one of our workers that we brought back. He was somebody else. Yeah, actually, he was an night brewer guy.
Oh, well.
Yeah, I think so.
Wow.
Well, I'm pretty sure it was night brewer. He might have been last. But anyways, yeah, so he's still up. But, you know, he goes back against Oregon. It doesn't go against us.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still not good. Poor guy still can't go to work.
I know. Timeliness is huge. I think you guys understand that, but boy, I can't reiterate that enough as far as getting the facts together, right? Get everything. Talk to somebody else who may have seen it. Don't even talk to them. Just, hey, go write a paragraph of what we saw, you know, if it's a pretty good accident. That way you get the facts fresh for sure. Then you can kind of make an opinion on it, right? Before you're just shooting in the dark. Boy, we could have really fixed it if we had done this.
Good.
All right, we talked a little bit about workers' comp incurred costs before. You had a finger injury that was how much money?
It was over $20,000.
Do you have stitches and rehab or anything like that?
He broke his finger and they had to drill it and then put a pin in it. And then after it was all healed, then they had to pull the pin back out. I think it was 20-something thousand. I had a mechanic in our shop. This guy worked in Ready Mix, and our mechanic in our shop was putting a brake drum back onto an axle and caught his finger between the brake shoes and the drum and broke it. And it was like $8,000 or something like that. Just for that. I mean, he just had to go to the doctor a couple times and get it reset and, you know, all that stuff. But I mean, they can't do anything for you.
Everybody laughs at it.
But they want you back every week. And, you know.
Hey, we had a guy hammering a pin into, I think he was working on a loader, but he was hitting a pin. You know, a pin is hardened steel, and he was using a hardened steel hammer. And a piece of the pin broke off and hit him right here. It severed two tendons. So he was out for 6 weeks with physical therapy, surgery. 6 weeks in the middle of last summer out of Medford. That was probably the worst injury that we had last year.
Whenever two guys get in a fight.
Really?
One of them kicked the other guy in the knee and blew his knee out. And he was off work for a year.
Oh,
and
man.
Now he's retired because he can't come back for it.
Holy crap.
What do you think that cost?
Oh, man.
It's risky enough at work. Now you got people fighting each other.
Over an arrows.
Over an arrows? That'll do it, man. Those things are
really good.
Jesus.
Really good.
Oh, jeez.
What happened to the guy? I mean, the other guy.
Well, the one got fired.
Yeah.
The other one you can't fire. He's an employee and he's injured on the job. It's on the job.
It's working on
you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, that had a touch of work.
It did. It's
more. Yeah.
Not to mention before he had to pin.
Yeah, and now he's 55 years old and he can't finish his working
career. We're down there.
Two truck drivers last year running a big dog on the contest. They got a separate program by the company. These two guys, you ready to come up? come up here, so I went up there and said, you go home for a week, you go home for a week. Middle of summertime, the contract truckers, they didn't like it.
The only thing we did do that we should have done at the time, the one guy that got hurt, didn't think he was hurt that bad. We should have had the cops out there, but we should have had the other guy arrested.
It's assault, huh? Boy, that's terrible. One of my old bosses said, this business would be easy if it wasn't for employees and customers. Why can't I just do my job? I gotta deal with this. We kind of talked about this, right? The last 3 years, 5 years. Hopefully none of you have had that. You're not gonna get there.
You're about in the industry, but
yeah.
Anybody?
Doesn't matter whose name's on the door, huh? That's not good.
For sure.
Costly? She's preventable? These are rhetorical questions. These are all true. How do you explain to an employee's family why they were injured or killed on the job? I don't want to do that. I'm not interested in doing that. What's next here? Where does the rubber meet the road? How do we actually achieve zero accident safety performance? How can we really walk the walk and not just talk the talk? Anybody work at a safety culture where this was more of the culture of safety? Maybe at your first jobs or in your early years of it, of this type of industry? Mm-hmm. Or you were maybe you got in trouble for getting hurt? A lot of backlash, right? God, sorry, man. Just bruised myself. This is what we're after here, the proactive. Kind of an overused word, but it's true. It sucks to react to something after it happened. Putting a guard up after something blew off and hit a guy. Have more of a proactive safety culture, and you're gonna have way more success. That's tough, though. You gotta set the good example, right? And it's nice when people catch you doing something, isn't it? It's not nice, but eye-opening, right?
Try not to be in that position.
I think I picked up my computer bag the other day, and the guy's like, "Hey, you're getting engaged, man." Or speeding or something.
Blow your back out of the
way. Yeah, exactly right. Yeah, I mean, even when you set the good example, people care about what you care about, right? The boss doesn't give a rip, neither do I. Just because I have to sit through the safety meeting doesn't mean that guy cares.
I have to get rid of my radar detector.
That's
proactive.
That's right. That's right. As a safety culture, it's tough to be reactive, and it hurts to do it, and it's not the best method, but, you know, you have to react to stuff and make changes based on an accident. It sucks. And being proactive is a tough sell also, because nothing's happened, right? And now you're implementing this whole change based on what? Based on your assessment of that risk? Based on my assessment of that hazard? Be a tough sell for somebody like me, right? That's why I take my managers out to lunch a lot. You guys have safety coordinators specifically at your work?
Yes.
A consultant, right?
We have a consultant, yeah.
Good. Do they put on training or?
Oh, yeah.
Do they do inspections and stuff?
He does do inspections, and like at the mine, we also have the company that we're mining for as for safety.
Sure.
People on staff, they come out and do spot inspections for us. Unannounced, they just show up. We actually had a clear inspection 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, how'd it go?
A clear of zero.
Oh, clear. Yeah.
Everybody said it could be done, but we got through it with zero. So we're pretty happy about
that. That's pretty surprising. These guys are paid to find stuff.
Yeah, we're pretty happy.
No backup alarms or? That's a big one.
One of the trucks didn't have a backup alarm, but they're not ours.
Oh, okay.
So that goes on.
Hard hat, safety vest, steel toes.
No issues.
That's worth celebrating, right?
Yeah, it was. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I ordered everybody sweatshirts back then yesterday.
That's great.
Yeah.
All right, put this on. Let's party. Start running with scissors. We're safe. What's that?
We'll take your pizza.
That's right. That's where the rubber meets the road is you guys, right? The examples you set. You have to care, right? Nothing's going to come out of it if you're just going through the motions. People are signing a form. Okay, back to work. Safety last, plus ask. There's kind of some examples of those two cultures, if you will, right? Mushroom theory. Just don't, just work, okay? Just go to work. Don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. But what about, hey, can I get, shut up, just work. We all want to be treated like adults, right? We all want to be involved. We all want to be trained properly. And we want to know what's expected of us, right? We've had some success when we've explained the accountabilities to managers and employees. What's expected of me? What's expected of you as a manager? It sounds kind of basic to ask your boss that, but you guys should all go to your boss's office and say, what's expected of me regarding safety? Yeah, I don't know.
We know what ours expects of.
What do we do? Do?
Pretty strict. Pretty consistent, right?
You know, when we bid a job, I'm sure Niker was the same way. We had money in our jobs for safety. And every job has
it.
Some jobs you spend it, some jobs you don't, but on average, there's money there to do it right. And so that's the expectation.
And if you didn't spend it, somebody got hurt.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah, absolutely. Why does safety culture succeed or fail? There it is, consistent active accountability followed through for measurable performance against stated goals across all lines, managers, supervisors, foremen. It's got to be, right? It's got to be from the start. It's got to start at the top, right? If the president of the company, the owner of the company doesn't care about safety, you think the guy working directly under him does?
Trickle down. You got to believe it.
Absolutely. We're fortunate at Peterson that our executive managers are definitely on board with safety. And it's nice to have that in your back pocket, too, you know? I mean, when you're trying to sell this stuff and get it out there, it starts with the top.
Your boss.
What's that?
You blame it on your boss.
Exactly right. And it shows. People know that, you know? People know that when they go to safety meetings. They know that when they participate in a tailgate meeting. They know that when they make a suggestion to a supervisor or a foreman. That it matters, and absolutely it has to. And ours wasn't always like this. I mean, that's for sure. Either it actively exists or it doesn't. I mean, that's pretty true. What do you think the shift was? 10 years ago, you think, in safety? 5 years ago? Cultures at your house, at your
own seems
place?
Like it's every year for us, really. I mean,
get better.
Know. 20 years ago, we didn't sweat it at all, it seemed like.
No safety glasses, no earplugs.
No, safety vests, no.
Safety
vests. You know,
vest.
None of that kind of stuff. We started talking eye contact.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure you can see the guy and he sees you, and then
yeah.
You know, it just grew from there.
You gotta get the same. Snowballing, right?
Doubles or triples every year,
mm-hmm.
You know, to what you have to.
You gotta do it, right? Get on board, man. There's room.
Yeah, right.
For sure.
It's expected, like you say, now the cultures
mm-hmm.
really changed.
That's where we made the shift as a company. That was one of our successes when we finally got guys involved, engaged, managers that are accountable for safety. Rather than the safety guy does that, Tyler could take care of that
mm-hmm.
for me. I gotta close these work orders. I gotta meet with this vendor. I gotta hire somebody, you know. Now they're involved in it. They're absolutely, the culture shift has changed. And that's a good thing. Oh, man. There's your old timers, right here, the bottom one.
Yeah. Very much.
You probably heard that within the week, haven't you? What's your favorite one up here?
It won't happen to me.
That middle one there. Yeah. That's a scary attitude, isn't it?
Yeah. Thought I was invincible for them.
At home, alcohol abuse.
No.
Ex-wife.
Those are common, right? We have them here too. I'm too busy to deal with that. We'll just get the job done. Ugh.
Figure it out next time.
Makes me sick right there. Why'd you do it? You knew about it. Fix it. We'll get to it. There's a good comic right there. Injury scheduled for today, right after you fail to pay attention. These are the critical elements of Peterson's zero accident program. That's the program that we have at Peterson. It's just it's like a triangle, and it's the logo zero accidents. That's our program. It's easy to promote because we all want everybody to go home at the end of the day with their fingers and toes, and eyeballs. when you keep that in mind, it's easy to promote, and it's not difficult to accomplish in the sense that it's just not hard. You know, it's easy to get into the safe mode, and we want you to. Managing for prevention, we talk about the proactive quite a bit. That's where we've had some success in our inspections, in our safety meetings, when we have a proactive attitude and an approach towards safety. That's a good critical element, and we've had some success there. That's back to the documenting, completing, and documenting regular tasks, activities. Those are for skills, culture, and awareness. You guys document your tailgate meetings. Do you document them online, or do you document them in a file?
Yeah, and everybody has to sign it. That was
everybody signs it, good. What if a guy misses a training session? What do you do?
Just pick him up the next time.
What about a monthly meeting?
More of the truck drivers and that, where they can all get together at the same time. We'll do it throughout the course of a month, you know, where everybody
good.
Gets it, but just maybe not at the same time.
Is that true for everybody here? You guys do. What if you guys on vacation?
What kind of training session?
A monthly training meeting.
Just
like
a safety
committee?
Mm-hmm. No, safety meeting. A monthly safety meeting. What if a guy misses it?
Like then we actually do a daily talk first thing in the morning before we go to work, then we do our weekly tool and safety meetings. And
do you have a specific monthly one where you talk about a specific hazard?
No, what we do is we track when guys are due for certain training. We'll just train the whole crew if we have people that are due for something.
Do you put the responsibility to attend those meetings on the employees?
When we have a safety meeting, the whole job shuts.
That's right. We do it before a shift.
What if a guy's on vacation that day?
Well, he would get the next one the following week.
But does he make up the one that he missed?
No, there would be no way he'd want to make up the one that he missed.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
They come out with pre-done ones for every week, you know.
Okay.
If we have an accidental ladder, somebody gets hurt on the ladder the next month, there's going to be something on that.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, where you're always going to back up, and then you'll investigate the accident, and then they'll show everything about
it. Our safety committee meets once a month.
Yeah,
and
that's Oregon law too, right?
Yeah, and minutes from that go out to all the job sites. And
great. What do you talk about at those ongoing issues?
Yeah, ongoing issues, how we do things better if, like you say, somebody gets hurt, there's been an incident report or an accident report.
What's the outcome of that report, type of thing?
Good.
One of the things we've had success on is putting the accountability of somebody who missed a monthly meeting back onto that employee to where he says, well, remember, I got to make up that meeting, and then we'll kind of schedule them in to where we don't just say, don't worry about it. We like to go for 100% attendance is what we're after. It's a little different in our industry because guys are getting sent out to a field, or they're on vacation, or they're sick. So the meeting's going to go on anyway.
You guys aren't doing a weekly meeting.
Yeah, they are.
Or that.
Yeah. And then also a monthly one as well. But yeah, that's one of the newer things that we've implemented, and we've had some good success with that as far as guys getting on board to realize that it's up to them to make the meeting, and if they miss it, to make it up. So I would encourage you guys to do that as well.
How would they make it up?
Whenever they come back.
But you're not having a meeting.
Doesn't matter. They can sit down. All of our meetings are online.
Oh,
they can go through the PowerPoint.
Record them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Exactly. Or watch a video, or read something and sign it.
You make them do something.
Yeah.
And they will say
exactly. Exactly. And if, I would certainly encourage you guys to do the same thing too. That way, it's hard to do. It's hard to get everybody for us. But if you can get them to realize that, oh, shoot, I still have to do that meeting that I missed. Kind of a cultural thing, too, to where somebody will say, oh, yeah, that's right. Before I go out to that job, I got to get that meeting done. Just a little different. Probably last. Yeah, I guess we started this year. So a little different for you because it's everybody at once. Impossible to make it up.
See, for us, it'd be really tough because we're seasonal. Our construction crews, you know, they end in November and they come back in April, May, you know, and that's our biggest fear is when they come back is to try to get them back into that groove of safety, you know. We worry about the end of the season because everybody's getting complacent or just things seem to happen in October, November, you know, and then when they first come back, you know, it's a killer to have somebody get hurt, any kind of an injury at first of the year, you know. Because then you got to beat that up all year long.
You say a lot of injuries happen towards the end of the season?
Mm-hmm.
How come?
Just complacent people. Just, you know, I mean, we had a guy jump off a bridge one night, and he thought, when he jumped over the barrier, he thought it was the ground, and it was in the dark.
Oh.
It was about 2 o'clock in the morning. He fell over a K barrier and falls about 30 feet. Mm-hmm. and broke both of his legs, and I mean, that's that guy at Bang. They call him our bridge jumper.
Weather starts coming and you start getting the rain.
Yeah, you start getting slick and mud, and you know, there are just a lot of different things. But mostly, I think people just.
One of the things we'll talk about on the behavioral part of safety is how complacency can lead you to take your mind off of task. And that's a clear-cut example of, unfortunately, somebody doing that. You can also relate that to maybe the Friday before Memorial Day. What are you thinking about? Are you thinking about safety? Or you're at the lake.
Yeah.
All right. And you forget about the immediate hazard to you. Behavioral safety, we'll really touch upon that, and I think it'll hit home in that sense to really, you know, eyes and the mind on task. Really, guys, the key to all of it is to recognize what type of state you're in, though. When you're rushing, when you're tired, you got to combat those things by, okay, I got to slow down here. I got to stop going 90 miles an hour on the freeway and talking on the cell phone. And battle fatigue by maybe drinking some caffeine, taking a quick break. Those are all ways to recognize what type of self-trigger is what we call it. Self-trigger on what state of mind you're in. You guys really, really took upon that well. We'll touch upon that later. Clear accountability for measurable safety results. That's the accountability sheet we go through quarterly with our managers. We grade them, if you will. And you guys are getting, you're either receiving that report or you're doing it for somebody else. You guys have something like that at your work?
No, not quarterly like that.
I mean, something you could implement.
Yeah.
I would certainly encourage you to do something like that. And it's really not about number of injuries you have. It's just what are you doing to promote safety? Are you putting on a tailgate?
Yeah.
Are you getting people involved?
Yeah.
Are you fixing tooling?
Non-schedule type stuff mainly.
Yeah.
Is what we end up.
This is just a little formality of what probably already taking place. It'll give guys a constant awareness of where they're standing. Maybe something you can do. And timely, appropriate follow-up for all incidents. That's another critical factor, element to our zero accidents. You almost want to go overboard, right, when you investigate an injury. You want to show up at the scene right away, no matter the severity of it, too. I mean, and you kind of almost go overboard where guys will be like, afterwards, they'll tell their coworkers, my God, it's been 2 hours because I freaking cut my finger. But it goes a long way in the mentality that they really care about this. They want to know what happened. They care about my health, right? They care about my safety here at work. And you kind of have another meeting almost by happenstance of, you know, you showing up there and making a big deal out of it. That's huge. Do you guys do that? Do you get with them right away when there's an accident? No. Right away. We've also had success with doing what's called a stop the shop or an injury alert, like two-sentence email to all the managers within our territories, telling them what happened and advising them to stop the shop for 5 minutes and talk about what just happened. So is there anything like that at your workplaces? Good.
Not quite as good as that, but it's
okay.
It kind of goes around to those senior managers, and then
okay.
If it's something that's pretty important, then it's stopped and talked about right then, each crew together.
Good. And we call them injury alerts or stop the shops. It doesn't have to be much, right? Just 3-4 sentences, a little paragraph. Yeah, we just had a guy cut his finger in Chico. This is what he was doing.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to your guys about it. Let's not do that again.
One thing that we do, too, MSHA sends out their alerts, you know, their safety alerts, and when something happens, mm-hmm. You get one of those that might pertain to something you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm up on a board after.
Do you get the fatal grams from MSHA?
Oh, yeah.
Did you see the one recently on the 988G?
That was our guy. That was an Knife River employee.
That was in Minnesota, right?
The bucket dropped on.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. They were lifting a conveyor, and well,
they were lifting
a lot of different things being said. Nobody will say what happened yet because they can't. But
I just talked about it yesterday in Minnesota.
Yeah,
that's the one.
We're saying more about cats answer it.
Did you notice Caterpillar was kind of had their lawyer hat on when we put that on? Come on.
We just had an AT-38 down there at the plant that would come up at a lockup.
Uh-huh.
It didn't actually drop off when I told them, but you never knew when it would start working again.
Mm-hmm.
The rental machine.
Yeah. You could probably bet there's going to be more to that one.
Yeah,
well, the biggest thing is, you know, back in the old days when we had mechanical controls, you could feel it and you knew what it was doing. Now it's by wire, and each time that moves, it that may not change the potentiometer on the other end, but they give the same signal every time, and so it's inconsistent. And
I know.
And when you're in that tight of a deal, and you're overextending anyway,
right.
You know, I mean, God, in Coos Bay, we use booms and buckets, you know, and they're tied off, and it's like, Jesus, guys.
Get a 4x4 out there.
I mean, and these guys are now, they're bitching because they can't lift anything with their loaders. Well, God, we just had somebody killed.
It's a loader. It's made to pick up stuff and load it.
So now you can only pick up rock if you're in a wheelbarrow. Yeah. And if you have an IT machine that has a boom on it, you can move our blocks or something. But boy, other than that, you don't pick anything else up. You get a boom truck, a crane, you know,
excavators. Excavators are a little better. At least excavators will give you some specs on lifting.
Yeah. And you can see.
Yeah. Right. Usually. And they have a designated lifting point. Rather than just a shackle welded onto a bucket.
Yeah, that was really unfortunate. Anytime you have the talent, you don't even make.
Yeah.
But that one's going to be really...
Yeah, you can bet there'll probably be a PEI or product improvement or product support letter regarding that for a mechanical fix. Yeah. At least for an inspection from a cabinet mechanic. I'm just speculating, but I can see the future a little bit in that regard. And I think what else was on that safety thing that Kat submitted was use equipment as it was designed to do.
Well, anytime you alter it, you know, and that's altering the, because now you're lifting it over a bucket or cutting it, you know, you've altered the ability of that machine.
But you guys got compactors and loaders?
Loaders, excavators.
What size excavators?
Pretty big.
Yes. Pretty common, right?
Yeah.
You have a thumb on it?
Yep.
Nice. Yeah. Lots of training with hydraulics and lockout tag out or anything?
Yeah, a lot of lockout tag out.
Energy, like I said, it's either moving or about to move.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter if you're in the way. Just like logs, right? Those are the critical elements of ours. Those are really our kind of a backbone of zero accidents. If you can take anything from that, document, over-document. By the way, maybe document for a whole time. And then really take a look at that accountability sheet that you have, either with you or it's on the CD. But it's pretty cool. We've had some good success with that. I would encourage you to maybe implement something like that or it specifically. Here's a couple examples. What do you do if you see somebody lifting incorrectly? What do you do? What do you do here?
Stop and tell them how to do it.
You wait until the morning and say, hey, by the way.
The next day.
That's you. Do I have any pictures?
Don't let him lift me. Stop him.
What are you doing? There's a crane right there.
Yeah.
See these other technicians around you?
Would you go over and pick that up?
That's just one example of an unsafe behavior. I mean, there's hundreds of those, but yeah, you want to be immediately on the spot for sure. And the same goes for somebody using the correct method, right?
Reinforce positive.
Absolutely. It's almost more important than that. It's almost better to have a thank you than a you suck type of thing. You know what I mean?
Dumb shit.
And we're back to that old culture we talked about.
I can get on the end of that one more or less.
Back in your early days of Oregon, yeah. Did you start out in what industry did you start out in?
Logging.
See that tree cut it down.
I worked my way up to that.
Set those chokers.
See those chokers?
Yep. Dragging a cat around by a bull.
Do you ever do a formal documentation on something positive that you see?
And our site inspections.
Good.
We have to look at things that we see that don't look right, and then anything positive, we have to write that down and then acknowledge that with the foreman and get them to sign off.
Nice. Does that get relayed down to the employee who made that safe change or anything like that?
Yeah, we'll usually do, if it's something that we see right then, we go right over and just talk to them. Either way, it's bad or good.
That's huge. You
got to be looking.
Absolutely. Objective, right? That's great. That's really good. They should know that when you're coming to them, they're going to get either something you need to work on or something that you did good kudos on.
Well, we used to always look just for fall, and so when he came out, that's what they expected.
I know.
I got to get this stuff on. Now it's like it doesn't bother me to come on the job.
No, exactly right. You're not a threatening presence, right? How about you? Documented on positive things you see?
Good. Documented through our safety committee.
Right on.
We have one member from each site that forms our safety committee.
Cool.
So there's a little bit of a landfill collection on that type of stuff.
You ever do safety like on biohazards and needle sticks and stuff like that? Okay.
Asbestos.
It's like a hospital, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a whole other animal, huh?
We were just, and it was kind of funny, somebody mentioned safety directions, which Paul West does us too. We did asbestos and all kinds of stuff. But, right after we just got up this sport club training done, next day here comes OSHA. You know,
really?
Yeah. It is. They wanted to do a site inspection, which is fine, you know. But it was a
get out of here, OSHA.
It was a full-blown inspection, you know. I mean, it was lasted 3 weeks, but, you know, yeah, different days.
I mean, I guess they looked for training records.
Yeah, training records, employee interviews, noise, dissymmetry, all that.
Documentation on disciplinary things for safety, anything like that?
No,
okay.
No.
Interesting.
Yeah. This lady was from the compliance side of OSHA, so, you know. We didn't get any monetary citations.
That's good.
With, the end thing was. So.
That's good. Yeah, the positive stuff is just as important, if not more, like I mentioned. The more you do that, you're going to have a really, really great culture. If you're not doing it already, it sounds like you all are. Look, I can't encourage that enough either. Make sure that's very consistent. Man, this guy hasn't noticed me at all. I've been working safely for a year. He won't say anything to me. I'm wearing my safety glasses, I got my vest on, I sleep with this damn thing on, I got a hard hat on. Tell me I'm doing a good job, crying out loud. Just give me something, boss. Oh my gosh, talk about documenting, right? Death by paperwork, if you will. Anything jumping out at you guys as far as you're not doing? Daily, weekly tailgate meetings, those are huge. I got a great resource for you guys at the end of this, safety.cat.com. Pre-job briefings, anybody doing that in a formal sense? Two guys working on the job together, getting together and doing a pre-job briefing, writing down what you're gonna work on? What are the hazards associated with
that?
Yeah,
certain things.
We
call ours JHAs.
We do JHAs.
Good. Those are great.
We had a really good one. I'll share this with you guys real quick. Our general manager in Coos Bay came out to our safety meeting in the shop one day, and he came around the corner and he sprayed something. And he goes, "Oh my God, it's in my eyes. What am I going to do? Help me!" You know, and God, everybody just freaking out. You know, don't know what to do. So I tell one guy, I said, "Run get the MSDS.
MSDS.
And so we looked it up. God, we're trying to figure out what it was, and he shoots it again. You know, and it's like, and he just freaked us out, but he taught us very quickly about how to find something and then how to organize it in our books so that if it's a can of starting fluid, you know what to go for. You know?
Right.
And that was probably the best lesson.
I mean, let him have fluid.
But I mean, he caught all of us off guard. We weren't expecting that. And everybody now, you know, they're ready for it. It's pretty cool.
That's great. That's a great tip. If you guys don't have your MSDS categorized, that would be something that would.
We do now.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's what, degreasers, paints, solvents?
We do it by product.
Okay.
You know, if it's, you know, paint.
3M.
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. Good lesson, right?
Oh my God.
Where's the eye wash station? What do I do? Good. What's RPE? That stands for Respiratory Protective Equipment. Who's working on that chromite? You got an inhalation hazard there?
No.
No, we've done sampling and we really have minimal dust.
Nice.
They do have it at the plant in certain places.
Nice.
And they have respirators required.
So fit tested every year?
Absolutely.
Or a doctor's evaluation?
I think you have to in Oregon. If you wear a respirator, you have to. Yeah.
You smoke 2 packs a day, I'm going to give you a respirator.
And not a doctor, but a what do they call them?
An industrial hygienist.
Hygienist, yeah.
Yeah.
But somebody has to sign off. No facial hair.
Right. You could probably get away with that, maybe.
Yeah, the mustache, I think, is, I don't know.
Can't have anything done.
Yeah, right through here, the underground, middle shave right here. Yeah.
And then also you want to train on the positive and negative aspects of a respirator, putting your hands over the exhalation.
Exactly.
You want to do that every time you put on a respirator.
Yeah.
Are there anything others that you guys do? Can you think of anything else?
Hearing test. Oh, well, it's on there.
Hearing test, yeah. A threshold shift is what they're looking for, right?
Oh, we've got tons for the construction industry.
You have earplugs available?
Oh, yeah.
You have three different types of earplugs available?
Yep. Yeah, I think we do, and we also have the muffs. Yeah. And we have
that's a form of ear protection, right?
Muffs, yeah. Two different types of earplugs.
A hearing loss accident is frustrating, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
OSHA recordable hearing loss, have you ever had one of those? Mm-hmm. Why is it frustrating?
Well, you got to have a baseline, number one.
Right, they're all preventable, yeah.
And they're all preventable, so you, and you need to know, you know, where did that happen, how did it happen?
Right.
How do you go back? Somebody might have been hearing loss for 20 years.
I know, man. That's why it's frustrating. And then you say, well, what do you do on the weekends? Well, I'm in a band. I ride motorcycles and I chop five cords of wood every month. Problem. This happened at work. According to OSHA, it happened at work, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
God, get me started on the hearing loss. Make sure you have the earplugs available. Make sure
they use them.
Make sure they use them. Make sure they like them. I have to wear these, but they give me a headache. Well, let's get you a different type. Everybody's ears is different. Make sure they know how to put them in properly, right? There's a training on how to put them in. And then greasy mechanics. Good to go. Now you got to clean hand, pull your ear up like that, straighten your ear. Now, that's the way to put it in your plug.
Do you guys do noise decibel creator?
Mm-hmm. You have a smartphone?
Yeah.
You have a decibel meter on that?
Mm-hmm.
It's free.
Yeah, probably do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, the apps.
I got one right here.
You're a safety guy. You're supposed to have it.
I got to keep it under 100 decibels. Right now, I'm at 68, 69, 65, 64. So somebody clap. It wasn't that loud. Come on, clap. 70. What's a chainsaw running? 110? What about an arc welder? What about a 1-inch impact gun?
What about an air arc?
Nothing's
hurt my ears, and I'm good.
That's a free application right there. That's a decibel meter. It's measuring.
Really?
You've also got time frames and shift hours and all that, and you've got to figure into your hearing.
Yeah.
So, there's a lot too. You're better off just telling everybody where your earplugs.
Exactly.
You know, and if you have somebody that is does have loss of hearing, you know, this is one of our senior guys, you know, or experienced guys. Boy, they're really hard on the new guys coming in, and that's probably one of the best things because
it is. Hear
they
pressure.
Don't want that guy to suffer the same thing that they've done.
Exactly. The safety glasses and mm-hmm. ear protection. Yeah. They're everywhere you go, and you're crazy enough. You.
Exactly.
Yeah, when you walk up behind me and they start talking, I yell out here.
I got a mechanic that can't hear an air leak on a truck or something.
Well, this is a good training tool, and again, just go to a search app, and it's free. Just type in dB for decibels. So guys over here working really loud, you just go right up to them.
Showing your decibels.
I've done this numerous times. And I look up, like, dude, you're at 105. Why don't you have earplugs in?
Yeah.
This is proof. These are calibrated, too. There's like three of them you can get. All about the same. Within plus or minus three. All of you should get that on your iPhone.
Yeah,
we don't have that. You got a flip phone? All right, we'll talk.
I don't really do that. I got the old Nokia still.
We're going with droids.
Yeah, they're free apps. Right, they might be on there, too.
Yeah.
Did you get one?
Yeah.
Did you get one with the heel on that?
It does. It's got a person to gauge.
Yeah.
Like a car. Oh, yeah.
What am I at? 65?
That's downloaded. I'll
tell you.
Give me
a minute. It'll be the same guy as
do it. Walk up to somebody that's not wearing earplugs and show them.
Yeah.
It's proof.
Yeah.
I do it.
No, I'll tell my boss.
Don't do it to your wife, though. You please stop doing your
ass.
I take no blame for that. Safety diet, Peterson.
Yeah.
She always tells me she's going to talk to the range of decibels to hear them, so I hear them.
Selective hearing, right?
That's what she means.
Do what you say you're going to do, right? Be consistent in your safety activities.
I was laughing on my way up.
You got it now?
It is, yeah. Raising.
Is that the one with the needle like that?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a
mm-hmm.
They're all about pretty accurate, too. Did that go up?
Yeah, 82.
There you go. You used to have a little microphone thing that you had to...
Yeah.
It was called a dosimeter. What is a dosimeter? Yeah, that's
the other option was a microphone.
Okay.
We're going to change this meeting about to apps, right?
That's right.
I got a compass the other day and a bubble level, too.
Really?
Yeah. Did you get the flashlight yet?
Yeah.
No, dang it.
Oh,
I mean, I keep forgetting about the flashlight.
The one that I'm after is the one where you can scan the business card.
Yeah, right.
Right here.
Oh, the little, the weird little box. And
right, just, you just take a picture of somebody's business card.
Yeah,
you just
card, your flashlight. Yeah,
that
thing is
on
fire. All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Kids need to play those.
Yeah, just easy baseball. Yeah.
Oh, the bubble.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah, just gotta have one of those.
Oh my god.
Right? Can you turn it the other way? Cool. Yeah, you can.
I think the best thing about a tool is leadership
on more level.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. And you can go like that too. Oh,
Whoa.
Sorry.
That's okay. I love
you
this.
You started it.
I just got this like 2 weeks ago. I haven't put the thing down yet. Oh my God. The best thing about a tool, though, is care, you know, employees care about what the boss cares about, right? You got that at the bottom for a reason. What's important to employees is what's important to the boss. When my boss tells me to do something, I'm probably going to do it. If my boss doesn't care about it, I'm probably not either. So walk the walk, talk the talk, right? Start because they're watching you, aren't they? They're watching you drive.
Every minute.
Dude, I saw you on the road with your phone to your ear. I saw you. Ah.
Nope. Guilty. Don't have it.
A few months ago, that was still working.
I know. Yeah. I'm California.
We just implemented a policy that we spent. I think we bought 40 of those
hands-free.
Yeah.
We just talked about
all the mirrors. The actual mirrors?
Yeah. No, it goes right on the visor.
The visor.
Oh, we're looking at the OnStar mirrors. You can just buy that mirror now.
Huh.
Oh, yeah. Give you the,
that's cool. That's,
but they won't work in our sim. I was already looking into it for that. For some reason, they.
Yeah.
But we just spent $35 a piece for them. So.
Yeah.
And but we've got a policy that we're talking on a cell phone.
Well, ours is too. Yeah. It's really funny because you can't talk on a cell phone. You can talk on a CB, but you can't talk on company radio.
Yeah.
What the heck's the difference? Company radio, CB, same thing.
Yeah. Commercial
you're
driver.
You're still distracted.
Commercial driver can't even dial anymore.
Nope.
We just did a distracted driver type thing. Everybody had to sign it. Mm-hmm. Like,
so that's where OnStar is now, really.
Yeah, right.
Absolutely.
Don't forget about your dogs in the front seat of your Camry.
Well, and you know, Ford now got that scene. You know, my phone, as soon as I get in to start my pickup, it sinks in, and if somebody calls me.
That's pretty slick there.
It makes it pretty nice.
They'll still allow you to make a sandwich while you're driving down the road.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, you can eat, taco.
Put on your makeup in the mirror.
Well, I talked to some lady the other day, stopped at her at a green light, putting her eye makeup on.
I see this one.
And you look great.
She was struggling with me.
Oh, yeah.
There's people in Roseburg like that driving down the freeway all the time. This younger gal. They're always in a hurry. They're doing about 90.
Yeah.
It is a generational thing, right? There's texting is just a new form of communication.
In Nevada, I think it was last November, a John Davis trucking driver, T-Bone and Amtrak train.
Yeah,
there were like 8 people. They were doing the trucking for us out there.
That.
So they've got a couple of years until the lawsuits all come, the bills come in, and then they're done. Mm-hmm. And they're uninsurable after that.
Remember the BP oil spill 2 years ago? Yeah. It hadn't even begun the lawsuits involved in that spill. You had fatalities and explosions. And how many millions of gallons of oil? Remember that accountability form that we use for managers? This is just kind of some scoring on that. I'll kind of skip through some slides. We'll get to some good pictures I got. But this is on that CD as well, so I won't spend too much time on it. But it's really just little effort. Nobody really gets a zero because everybody's kind of doing something out there. And you get extra effort, too, if you go above and beyond. Maybe a foreman takes a picture and develops a safety meeting. That's pretty cool. When you got employees engaged like that, that's outstanding. That's a little bit above and beyond, I would say. So you get a little extra point for that. That's just one example. Oh my gosh, do you know what's expected of you? I think you guys are doing most of this stuff. Foreman put on safety hold, things I see you do, right? There's that quarterly. I think you guys will get a lot out of that. Really take a good look at that after the meeting tomorrow or whenever. You know, like that performance report. That's the accountability thing I was talking about. We shoot for over 95 points at Peterson, and the scoring's a little bit different. You can get like a 90 is technically like a C, so but it'll explain it to you there. But it's pretty good. Guys like it. Kind of keeps them on pace is what they're expected of them. And their scores vary throughout the year, and it's okay, but it's just ongoing, and it's a good thing. Employee expectations, right? No one follows safety rules, policies, timely incident. That back injury right there, back, remember the timely reporting of an injury, that's huge. Yeah. Employees need to know that that's expected of them. If they don't know, now they know. Use best safety practices for all tasks. We now have implemented a safety component in an employee's evaluation too. Hey, you're a good mechanic, you fix stuff on time, you're accurate in your repairs. You're also safe. That's part of their evaluation. Is that any of your guys' evaluations? Right on.
We don't evaluate our employees, the management people get evaluated.
Cool. What about when an employee, kind of a new employee, maybe an entry level employee, does he get evaluated on his safety? That'd be good too. It'd be good to implement something like that. Even if it's not that formal, but just kind of talk about it at their evaluation, I think it would go a long way.
So how would you evaluate somebody that hasn't worked for you?
Maybe after 6 months, through their probationary period, something like that. And you almost want to kind of have an exchange of expectations, you know, during that evaluation and say, hey, do you know where everything is? Do you know there's earplugs available? Do you know, is there any questions you might have? You're a new employee starting out, we want you to keep all your fingers and eyeballs, so I think that'd be a good element to add to any evaluation, really, is safety. Not just performance on how well you work, but on how safe are you. Timely follow-up for all incidents, I talked about that a lot. OSHA 300 logs, you guys know what those are, you have to post them every February. It shows you how many injuries you had last year. That's important. That OSHA inspector probably looked for that. Site visit, right?
Yeah.
Where's your 300 log? Hold on, let me grab the old ones out of the way. You want 2005 or 2006? Yeah, have the current one up there for sure. Oh, we have a stretch and flex program now this year. You guys stretch at your work?
I haven't talked about it for many years.
Oh, you got to do it. You got to do it. We just started this year.
Hurts our backs.
We're 300. You can't get hurt at the same time.
I thought they were going away from that.
Well, we started it this year. Guys love it. It's 5 minutes.
The warehouse did it 20 years ago. They have people out there doing jumping jacks every morning.
Right? No, we don't go that far. No, we do eight stretches, and it takes 5 minutes. It's voluntary, but they get paid to do it. You guys stretch at your work?
We don't as a company, but we are now working for some general contractors that have been doing that. So
cool.
Once a week.
The guys love to do that. Yeah. They get paid to do it. It's 5 minutes. It's kind of a little camaraderie thing, too. Yeah. And we've been doing it for, this is 3 months now. I was skeptical at first.
Some little cutie out there in a leotard.
That would help.
That'd be a little incentive. I've done tests on. I've taken donuts to job sites, and I've taken bananas, grapes, and yogurt to job sites. And what do you think ends up in the trash?
Exactly. Right.
Yeah.
I don't know if the stretch and flex program is on there, and if it's not, I'll give you my cards. I can email you that program to you. And there's 8 stretches that we do. Want to implement that, that'd be awesome. We've had great luck with it, really. 5 minutes, 5-6 minutes.
Every day.
Yeah, we start at 7 usually, and they do it from 7 to 7:05. People are kind of congregating around the coffee pot at that time anyway, so you may as well get together and stretch.
Yeah,
just 5 minutes.
We're doing it during the safety meetings or something, but it doesn't happen to be every day.
That was something that we, as a company, looked at last year and looked at all our back injuries and strains, and it was kind of a reactive fix, unfortunately. A lot of injuries that we have.
Most of those types of injuries happen right off the bat first thing.
Yeah, I know. Their muscles are cold, right?
Yeah.
Think of a football player. Does he just run onto the field and start playing football? No, they stretch. Okay, it might not be as strenuous and demanding as a football player, but you're wrenching on something pretty hard in our situation here, and it's physical.
Yeah.
Let's be honest about it. You got to stretch and you got to warm up, or you're more susceptible to having something pulled, a hamstring, backs for sure. Tough. Invest investigate why. We'll go through some why questions here. Reduce injury, worker compensation costs, exposed deficiencies in process training or equipment. Are we not training properly? Is that part of the investigation? Is that what we found when we investigated an injury? Somebody not trained properly? Have you ever done this before? You ever asked somebody that when they get hurt? Have you ever operated that piece of machine before? Well, no. Oh, okay. That's a good start. Let's train you on how to do that. Those are just kind of common questions you want to ask during an investigation. Who, what, when, where, and why, right? Get all the facts. Get all the facts that you can. Why? You ask somebody why, and they're immediately accountable, right? I almost get a little bit defensive. Why did you put your finger there? Well, I'm not sure. So all kinds of things, all kinds of questions can come about. Horseplay? Can you horseplay at your work? Just fighting, right?
Just fighting.
That's incredible. Let's get through the slides here a little bit. Just some definitions in general. You guys know what a near miss is versus an accident, an injury or illness. I think a noise hearing loss is an illness, I want to say. I'm not sure. Yeah, noise-induced hearing loss is a horrible accident. I think it's an ocean illness. You guys seen that iceberg before? Kind of what's below there, right?
Oh, yeah.
What else do we need to look at here in this accident? Give you a chance to read that. Accidents are not just one of those things that happen inevitably. Accidents are predictable and preventable events. Boy, that's out of recruit, right? Just wish they knew when they were going to happen. Here's an accident weed. The root causes, if you will. Important stuff. And again, I can email you this presentation if it's not on that. If it's not on that CD. I got business card, but that's easy. You might not want to, you might just take a couple slides out and have a safety meeting about this picture. You know, you can do that. Yeah, that'd be cool. Why is the battery dead? The alternator's not functioning. Why? You keep asking why, and you're going to get down to the bottom of it, right? You do. You almost have to. And that bottom might be somebody saying, I wasn't paying attention. I was in a hurry. I was pissed off. I couldn't fix this part. And that's why I threw the hammer across the shop or something.
Did you
go to
hit that guy?
Yeah. Some more definitions here. I'm going through this clip. Results of investigation. Sometimes there has to be disciplinary actions, right, based on an investigation. Maybe a repeat offender, if you will, right? The proverbial rain cloud over the sky. Wherever he goes, he gets hurt. What's wrong with you? You guys not paying attention. Guy doesn't care.
Anybody that has an incident with us, if it's a near miss or whatever, then ask to go to the safety committee meeting the next month and go before the safety committee meeting and talk about it as an incident.
You know what? That's a good idea. I think it gets
around really fast.
We should do something like that.
We did grab one for 25 years, started getting unsafe, so we started writing them up.
Uh-huh.
They ended up getting hurt. Spent 6 weeks healing up, and we come back and fire them.
Really? So, yeah. We can't afford to employ you.
I wouldn't know we couldn't. I told them I'd rather walk down the street and meet you under him and call me a dirty SOB than have to go tell your wife that you got killed because you were stupid.
I'm not interested in you. No. Neither are you. We can't afford to have you work here. This is why.
Those are tough things.
We started work there together. So that was pretty tough on them.
When you've got a chain, when you've got documentation there, you're absolutely in the right there, for sure. Probably should have happened a long time ago, huh?
Really should have.
Yeah.
You know, let go too long.
That's a document we use for looking at an alternative result of what happened in that situation. It's called STAR. Situation, task, action. Star R would be alternative result. That forms in there as well. Pretty cool. That's the star. Well, workers' comp claims. Only thing I want to say on that is to get the 801s in and how fast?
With
sort of.
Yeah.
5 days. Oregon law, 5 days, 801s. You guys all familiar with the form, 801? You're not familiar with that?
No.
You just came back to Oregon law. We have at the office, but you can line up.
It's just kind of an incident. It's just a one-page form, yeah. If you get rusty at doing the 801s, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
That means you haven't been doing them that often. When you can do them in 2 minutes or less, you're probably coming too many. 801's pretty common. Return to work. We have that program. Peterson, you guys all should have that as well as an opportunity for guys to come back to work. That's good. Well, he said I was fine, I can come back. Meanwhile, he's laid out with back spasms and whatnot. Behavioral safety, so we'll touch upon this. Prevention is better than reaction. That's kind of a theme of today, right? Proactive approach to safety. Some examples of behavioral safety, recreation. This is a theme that we talk about with new employees. You guys have new employee safety orientation?
Yes.
Does it take a day or 2 days, something like that, a week? How long does it take you guys after your work?
You want 2 minutes?
Really?
I mean, we have a pamphlet that everybody goes to when they're new, but then basically they're working side by side with people, and I guess it's a constant orientation, really. But
I would recommend you implement a new employee safety checklist.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to take long, maybe a couple hours. I would recommend doing that for you. And there's some stuff, there's some reasons behind that. There's some calculations that people have done that they're more likely to get hurt within the first 6 months of employment. So
I would get an accident within 5 miles of your house.
Yeah, exactly, something like that, yeah. So that would be something I would recommend to you, because we used to be the same way. We used to just kind of send them off to work and then try to catch them within 60 days. And we're like, we just need to do this in the beginning. So that would be something I would recommend to you. And we can talk later about stuff that you, a checklist to go through. And it's been really successful for us and helpful in reducing accidents on remorts, if you will. Recognize the hazards. This is one of the main things we talk about. Recognize, evaluate, and control. We all like to do stuff for fun on the weekends and after work, and we don't want to go home with a sore back and missing an eyeball. So we like the theme of recreation and doing stuff like fishing and hunting and camping and whatever you want to do. Ride motorcycles, operate chainsaws like that guy. So recognize, evaluate, and control the hazards that you face, right? Is it water on the ground? Is it a bucket in the air? A weather hazard, right? You're recognizing and controlling those hazards by slowing down, cleaning up a spill, taking the time to use a handrail, slips, trips, and falls, you guys talk about a lot, and the training that is involved. This training could be very useful in your slip, trips, and falls, addressing those hazards. Back injuries as well, too. Think about what you're lifting. Think about your destination, where you're going to put that thing. Guys might lift it properly, but then when they go to put it down, they got to go underneath something, and that's where they get hurt. And it's not heavy stuff either, necessarily. When you help your buddy move a refrigerator, you know going into it that it's heavy and you're going to have to bend your knees a little bit. When you pick up some 20 pounds, which we're all capable of doing, that's where you get hurt, because you get complacent with the hazard of lifting properly. So that's a good safety meeting as well. Recognize, evaluate, control hazards, materials, tools, equipment, people. Anybody ever work with anybody unsafe?
Yeah. Our head engineer, when he's got a machete and he's saying, you stay back. He chops his dog's nose off one day.
Oh, I'm taking the vet and get himself back on.
This is crazy.
That's not even at home, right?
No, that's at work.
I know. Unsafe conditions, unsafe behaviors, recognize unsafe behaviors, right? Dude, you need to slow down, man. Kind of an accident triangle here. For every 30,000 hazards, you're going to have 3,000 near misses in first aid, 300 recordable accidents, disabling accidents, and I don't even want to talk about the top one. Because when you live and breathe down in here, that's where you prevent from rising up on that triangle. I'll give you the nicks and cuts and stuff like that all day long, but let's learn from those. Let's learn from a near miss. Let's learn from a close call. And we'll live and breathe and swim around in this area here rather than going up the triangle. Here's the behaviors I think you guys will really get a lot out of if you implement a behavioral-based safety training program at your workplaces. This is just one example. I think you mentioned a 10 checklist thing that got you thinking about behavior, right? Same idea, right? Again, 90% of all accidents are caused when you go down to the root cause of somebody's behavior. Somebody was in a hurry, somebody was complacent, somebody was tired, somebody was frustrated. Those are behaviors that we all find ourselves into at some point or another, right? The key to all this is to self-trigger, though, when you realize you're in one of those states of mind. I just need to slow down, I need to walk away, take a little break, realize what I'm dealing with here. That's key. There's another stat there, managing behavioral hazards. Yourself. What's the main reason here? The main one is yourself, right? Events, something unexpected happens without you or someone else involved. I wish there were more of these, right? It would be easier to investigate, huh? It would be easier to do an injury investigation when something breaks and somebody got hurt because of that break. But it's not the case. It's usually somebody's behavior, like I said, 90% of the time. So you really have to ask the why questions and get down to the root cause of that injury or accident. Hazards change constantly. We talked about that. We don't work on an assembly line here. Sites change. People change, weather changes. Guys have good weekends, they have bad weekends. Right? No, never. They have other stuff on their mind, right, when they're working. It's important to keep their eyes and mind on task, behavior, right?
One was a little short, the other one.
Sometimes you just gotta shake your head, right? Got to hand it to them, though. They're pretty creative.
Yeah,
really.
Genius.
I think if you're tied off, that ladder's okay.
Or that one?
Yeah.
How do you get there, though?
You got to have ropes on the handle.
I shimmied up the mast with my tools and my pocket in my hand. Nice teamwork right there, man.
Yeah, everybody's standing on the board.
That guy might have been tired too.
You're hurting like a champion.
That's my car. So remember those four states of mind: rushing, frustration, fatigue, and complacency can lead you to these critical errors. Eyes, mind not on task, becoming in the line of fire, and then losing your balance, traction, and grip. Were any of your slip and fall injuries investigated and done when people were in a hurry and they lost their balance, traction, and grip?
Those were in a hurry.
In a hurry? Okay. Behavioral safety, guys, you're really going to benefit if you implement some sort of program of behavior as a training method. Oh, the gas pump. The gas handle in there, so.
Rider truck almost to bring
it. It's a California license plate too. Complacency is probably the biggest one that everybody battles. I think that's probably true. Rushing complacency is probably the biggest too. It's hard to change behaviors, right? That guy's standing in a loader bucket, right, with a ladder, changing a light bulb up there.
Wow.
I talked about that triangle when you analyze close calls and events that happen. You're in a good spot. That's part of a good culture there. If it's a habit, try to work on it. If it's a state of mind, think about what state it is and why it contributed to the state. We also talk about the three P's: position, protection, and procedure. And if you're in the wrong one of those, or you're not using the right stuff properly, this is something you guys could benefit from too as well. You could have a safety meeting just on this slide right here, right? Hey guys, we're going to talk about the three P's today and how they relate to injuries and accidents. We talk about this all the time. The three P's are very important. Around the equipment, obviously position, right? Where am I going to stand? Am I going to stand under that crane? Am I under a loader bucket? Do I have on the right PPE? I'm about to paint a machine. What do I need? Recognize, evaluate, control. Shout out JSAs, you guys do those job hazard analysis, you call them sometimes? JHAs. Pre-job briefings, talk about that. What's the right method to do a certain job, a specific job, right? Pre-job briefing, there it is. Working with two people on a job, working on a new machine, working on a different site. It's a pre-job briefing, right? Might not be as formal as writing stuff down, but you're going to get together. That's good. If you could document it, that would be easier. Oh, safety.cat.com. I would encourage you to all write that down. Because you can go to industry safety, and there's about 200 topics there, from forestry, construction. What else is on there?
So you guys are still going to be allowed to do that with your buckets and stuff.
Yeah.
You get out on the job.
If you're using the
proper lifting.
They have free videos on here. Everything's free. Free videos, free tailgate topics. They call them toolbox topics, but it's the same thing. Toolbox, yeah. There's probably 200 topics on there.
Yeah, I've been on your website.
Yeah, that's
good. Perfect. How to move a machine, how to transport a machine, how to get on and off a machine.
Yeah, videos.
They do.
You can download them.
They do. If you're not taking advantage of this, if you're running out of material to talk about at a tailgate meeting, take advantage of that for sure. Remember nothing else of today. Remember that website. And you're going to pretty much build your own safety program based on this site.
You could eventually.
They have a movie on there called Shake Hands with Danger. Have you ever seen that one? With Three Finger Joe. That's a classic Caterpillar video from 1979. I want to say.
You ever seen it?
Oh, you haven't seen it?
Oh my gosh.
I'll get on there once.
It's good. It's really good. They talk about a guy named Three Finger Joe who grinds off a couple of his fingers in a grinder and they talk about lockout, tagout, they talk about fire safety, but it's old, it's kind of funny, but guys really like it, and it's good. Shake Hands with Danger is called. It's on.
Yeah. I remember the one where the guy's putting a pin in a,
yes,
in a wheel loader, yeah, and he that's reaches always through the,
yeah,
pin, and there's a bee flying around in the cabin, the guy swats out,
oh,
cuts his
arm. Yeah, that's classic. Or they're moving a machine down the hill, and it kind of bumps it down the hill, and they eventually tips the machine over.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
Yeah, I have.
Oh, you got
oh
it.
Oh, my gosh, you haven't seen
that. That's your next safety move. Yeah. Shake hands with danger. Yeah,
well, they're on there. They're on there.
Yeah, they're on there. Yeah.
I'll watch it on my way home on my smartphone.
Oh, you're right.
Right, exactly.
It's way
speedy.
Yeah, yeah. I got a dash kit for my phone, so I put it in my kids right there in front of the kids.
I was afraid to move my up into my viewing farther.
This is a good one. Virtual same website. Virtual walk-arounds. If you get a new machine at your plant, something like that, everybody can watch a virtual walk-around and get together and kind of get familiar with the machine, right? We encourage operators to do that. This is a good training element too. Operator tips for them, right? Walk-around inspections. Toolbox talks. That's the one I was talking about. Oh, O&M manuals too. If you're ever short on those, you can download those. Those are free.
Cool. How far back are we?
I don't know. I'm not sure. VAKs? No, I don't know.
I've got one.
Do you?
We've got a road there every year.
It's probably about that thick, right?
Yeah.
Oh, the new one.
Right.
Yeah, this is a great site. Prevention through awareness. Voices fire.
In Oregonian.
What's that?
In Oregonian.
Well, in Oregonian?
Yeah,
we've got a building named after him now.
Go Bees!
Was he friends with...
He was Bees, yep.
Was he friends with Einstein, right?
Yeah, well, he was down at Caltech, is where he went, and then he taught there. He's the only American to win two Nobel Prizes, one for chemistry and one for peace, because he thought it was a bad idea for aerial nuclear testing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The Manhattan Project, right? Einstein.
Oh, yeah. Einstein, these both guys.
Questions? Comments? Use this stuff. Steal it. Make it your own. Cut and paste it. Call me. I'll come by. I'll walk around with you.
Get your car,
I'll bring donuts.
How do you guys deal with for your field crew, watch out, tag up procedures when you go on at somebody else's site to work on their piece of equipment?
Communication is probably the key one that we try to tell operators, owners. He's an old field guy. What do you do?
We do tag him out. Sometimes we turn the disconnect key off, zip tie a tag out with our name and phone number so the guy can call us and find out what's wrong if the machine's been down for a couple of days.
Gotcha.
But yeah, so mainly communication. You chalk the tires, tell anybody that's around, hey, I'm going to be working on this for a while so they know you're there.
Gotcha. That type of thing. I was just wondering, because I...
What do you guys do?
Out of the 18 years I've been with the landfill, I've never seen a walkout tag out from CAT.
Well, you can get that procedure on this line, too.
We have our own policy.
Okay.
Yeah, we do.
It's
pretty
lax. We have our own policy for our guys, but when somebody else comes on our site,
I think you just need to communicate that with them because they do it for us. We use a tag out, and it's usually on the steering wheel, so that anybody that gets in there, the CAT and deer, they
work with. You have to pull your deed when he's adding the machine out.
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot of times they'll hook the key right to that lockout tag out. Our biggest problem with that, with keys, is the crews like to leave the keys in the equipment. And I told my viewers, if there's a key in the piece of equipment, it does not have one when you leave. Oh my God, you ought to see the shit we have to look this morning.
Well, we run into problems too when the mechanic might drain the oil, right? And leave and come back. Oh my God, imagine an operator starting a machine with no oil.
Oh man. Oh.
But if there's a lockout tag,
they're not checking the oil before they start their machine.
Yeah. There you go.
But if there's a lockout tag on there,
set somebody up.
You're in a really good spot. Questions? Comments? Anything else?
Good job.
Thank you.
You can tell how safety has evolved because people talk about it very passionately now. Where in the old days, if you tried to hold this, we'd all said, I've got things to do.
Right.
But, I mean, that's the way it is in our country.
This would have been the first meeting of the day, not the last.
Yeah,
it's come a long way, huh? Yeah. Evolved is the right word, too.
Yeah.
Learn by experience, right? Learn by sharing techniques. That's what we hope to do here. Not perfect by any means.
Don't get me wrong. We have our challenges. We have our challenges as well, but we've come a long way. What I know, exactly. You always have the human element involved, right? Use this stuff. If you don't have something here, I probably have it. I can email it to you. That's really easy. Use me. I can come by your shop. I can look at something. I can do an inspection.
You're welcome at our place anytime you're
that's
in
Goose Bay. I've been med for once a month.
How far north do you how far
Goose Bay.
Do you
want to come to Goose Bay?
Ready?
Just come east a little farther.
Yeah.
Property. Okay, you
can't call. Gotta come through Roseburg to get to Goose Bay, right?
That's right. Pretty much. I can go to Roseburg. That's easy. Well, we appreciate you coming. I know you guys are busy, so appreciate
this
all
was
the
a
time.
Good day.
There's some surveys here. I hope you guys can fill them out. One of the questions that we didn't put on here, but Dwayne encouraged me to let you guys know, is what's the best time of year to do something like this? So keep that in mind at the bottom of this. You want to do it in the summertime? Can you do it in December when things are kind of slowed down? And you talk about seasonal stuff, it might be better for you. Just
Dirty
some thoughts.
Ducks football game?
So yeah, if you could make a comment on the bottom, what time was, you know, what's the best time of year to do something like this? Week of Christmas?
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm pretty sure the presentation is on that CD. If it's not, I can email it to you. It's extremely easy. Linus Pauling is from Oregon, you said?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was born in Portland and moved to Condon.
Oh, interesting.
And or he was born in Condon and moved to Portland, something like that.
Cool.
Yeah. Went to George Washington High School in Portland.
All right. On.
We got a building named after him in Oregon State.
Is that right? Yeah. Corvallis?
Yeah. They have a Linus Pauling Center. In fact, I think they just finished it about a year ago.
Oregon State and Sacramento State have a similar safety program with similar training techniques. That's two of the West Coast schools that have that for whatever reason, but I went to Sac State and I know the instructors were in touch with the Corvallis campus quite a bit when they traded training and class attendance and stuff like that. But yeah, Oregon State has a similar program in occupational safety. I'm dying to go to a game up here. I've never been to a Ducks or Beaver game, so I'd love to go to a football game up here. I know. Civil War, right?
Yeah.
That's best if you're a Duck fan.
Is it?
Yeah. Lately, it hasn't.
Well, yeah, they're really good.
Yeah.
They are really good.
That was a great rivalry for 15 years.
I know. Now they just wipe them up.
Yeah, it goes in spurts. So yeah, you never really know what's going to happen next year.
Did Oregon State keep their coach?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is that, what's his name?
Riley.
Mike Riley.
Mike Riley,
yeah. And so did Oregon. Chip Kelly stayed at Oregon.
Yeah, right. Yeah, which we're all pretty happy about. He seems to be a genius at this point.
Oh,
he settled that team.
I know. Incredible. They got a great running back, too.
Yeah.
You just keep those guys out of jail.
Yeah, oh, my God.
Behavioral safety training.
Keep
Oregon University
off the smoke. And
Keep
them from speeding. And
a lot of recruits are from California, so you can blame on them.
That's part of the problem.
It is.
The bigger the program gets, the more shady characters it ends up with.
Yeah, they used to call them the jailbaiters, but most of those guys now play at Oregon.
They have some characters to go there. Yeah, remember, drop down if you could, a good time of year for what's good for you to do something like that. Or like this.
You guys train your safety, train your office people?
Quarterly, yes. That's something we just started to do this year.
Yeah.
we realized we were having accidents and hazards addressed and, sure. By our office staff, so we're going to be quarterly meetings. One of them's on ergonomics, one of them's on fire safety, one of them's on slip, strips, and falls, and the other one is escaping me. I think it's driving safety. Yeah. We're going to meet every 3 months.
So would it be legitimate to write on here, how does this school end up on the same day as a Ritchie Brothers auction in our area?
It's convenient.
Yeah, was that planned?
I can't speak to that. I cannot. There was a Ritchie Brothers auction in Dunningham. You say?
Yeah.
Pretty good turnout.
Today was
Grants pass next month.
Yeah, a couple weeks.
Stuff's going pretty high, which is kind of encouraging, is what I heard.
It's all encouraging if you're settled.
Yeah, that's right.
Please leave these right here.
Please.
You.
Yeah, that'd be great. Food in your belly?
Yeah.
Appreciate it. Take care, Ron.
Hey.